This is episode 2 of the VPN bonding series. In the last episode, we doubled our internet speed by using two VPN tunnels and bonding two Openvpn tap interfaces together. This can be used to increase the internet bandwidth if you live in a rural area where no high-speed internet is available. The Linux bash script for this are on my GitHub repository. Check the link in the description. In this second episode of the Linux VPN bonding series, we will have a closer technical look at the scripts and the principles that make this possible. For a preview on the next episodes in this series, please see my call to action at the end of this video. If you don't want to miss out on further episodes, please do subscribe to my channel. If you like the video, please give me a like. This is highly appreciated. Thanks, guys. The Linux bash scripts that we use to achieve VPN bonding are heavily inspired by an article on serverfault.com. During my research for this video series, I realized that channel bonding and increasing internet speed is a big concern in the community. Many people are asking questions about this in the various forums. However, I could not find that many reliable answers that actually solve the problem. The link to the article on serverfault.com is in the video description section. Bonding ISO layer 2 devices, such as Ethernet devices, is nothing new in Linux. In the enterprise, this is a quite common solution to increase bandwidth, for example, to a heavily used file, mail, or database server. Sometimes in larger companies, the available 1 gigabits are just not enough, and a 10 gigabit infrastructure is not available. OpenVPN can use different interface types for VPN tunnels. Tap devices are quite similar to Ethernet devices and act on ISO layer 2. All you have to do in order to switch from TUN to TAP in OpenVPN is one single line in the config file of the connection and specify device TAPX or TUNX. When creating the interface with the MKTUN option, you can specify a device name. If the device name starts with TAP or TUN, then OpenVPN will choose the right device type for you. If you give devices a free name, then you would need to add the dev type directive. One catch-22 in the bonding configuration is the fact that you cannot bond an interface when it is already up. Therefore, we need to first create the tap device using the MKTUN option, then bond all devices, and only then can we actually start the VPN tunnel. So step by step. First, load the bonding modules, then create the bonding interface, then give it an IP address, and then create the tap device for each tunnel and set the bonding interface as the master. Looking at the interface configuration of our system in the Linux shell, we now see that the bond 0 interface and the tap 1, tap 2 and so on interface do exist. Please note that the tap interface has no IP address and it will not need any as it is ISO layer 2. IP addresses are layer 3. That means only the bond 0 interface will actually get an IP address. Once we have created all tap devices and we have added them to the bond, we can then bring the bond 0 device up. So if we do this on both sides, we can now already generate a bonded tunnel. At this point, all tunnels go over the same interface on the client side. But remember that what we want is actually aggregate multiple interfaces. By default, OpenVPN starts in no bind mode. That means it would, from a client perspective, just use the default gateway to get out to the internet. If we wanted to instruct OpenVPN to use different interfaces, then we have two challenges. That one actually cost me a couple of hours to figure out. First, we need to make sure that the tap device binds to the right physical device. In my example, I want tap 1 to bind to WLAN 0 and tap 2 to bind to Ethernet 0. I have no way of specifying a physical interface anywhere in OpenVPN, but I can define a local IP address. And as this local IP address is bound to a specific interface, this is nearly as good as specifying the interface directly. But it brings us to the second challenge. Even though the tap interface is linked to an IP address on the WLAN 0 interface, This does not mean that Linux will systematically try to reach the internet through that interface. It would instead go back through the default route, or rather use the default gateway. If we look at the available routes on our system, we see that Linux has automatically added two routes, one for each interface, but it has assigned different costs or metrics to them. Linux will first try the interface with a lower cost or metric before it would go through the interface with a higher cost. This can be useful for resiliency or failover configurations. Let's say use a 3G connection when your DSL is down. But we want load balance over both interfaces. So how can we achieve this? The solution is called routing tables and rules. In fact, we can tell the operating system to apply different rules for different interfaces. The client installation script has created these rules in the rt_tables file, but has left them commented out because I did not want to have any interference with the default routes as long as the bond is not up. The start bond script removes that comment using this set command line. In order to have two or three or four similar configurations, I'm using template files. If you look at the templates, you can find values that start with the @ sign. My script replaces these with the corresponding values for each tunnel. This is again done by a couple of set commands and regular expressions in the script. Talking about set in order to replace text with Linux, there is a couple of lines we might want to have a closer look at. In order to read out properties of the interfaces, I feed the result of the IP command into an array using the readArray command. Let's have a look at this line, where I actually want to find out the IP address of the physical interface, let's say WLAN 0. I use ip-br-addr. I then grep for the interface name in order to only get the line with the interface I'm looking for. Then I run set with this expression in order to replace multiple spaces with just one. That's important for the readArray command that can then fill in the templine variable. Templine index 0 contains the interface name, templine index 1 the state, and templine index 2 the IP4 address. Just a quick remark at this point. The Linux bash scripts are made for IPv4 only at the moment. If you only have an IPv6 address, then they won't work. I might change this in a future version. Now, the IPv4 address contains the network identifier, that is /8 for class A, /16 for a class B, or /24 for a class CNET, which corresponds to subnet masks 255.255.255.0. Proper subnetting, by the way, is an art of its own. The line I wanted to draw your attention to is where I remove the slash something from the IP address. Usually, you use slashes in regular expressions as a separator, but with set on Linux, you do not have to. As I am replacing a slash, I'm just using the @ sign as a separator. So in fact, I'm replacing slash something with nothing. I had to look this one up. I didn't know that I could just use a different character here. So in a nutshell, I go through the four template files, fill them with the right values, and then call OpenVPN with that config file. Basically, I'm doing this at runtime because your interface might use DHCP and possibly get a different IP address each time. But let's get back to our IP rules and routes. Look at the IP rules here. We have standard rules that should be available on any system, namely local, main, and default. And you can see here that they apply to all interfaces. Now, we can add rules for specific destinations or for specific sources. What we do here is we add a rule that applies for each of the IP addresses that we're using to bind our tap devices to, and tell Linux to look up a specific table for this rule. We can look at the routes in that table just by typing IP route list table and then the table name. I have named the tables VPN1, VPN2, and so on. We only need one single route per table, and that is just telling IP route which gateway to use on this interface. So basically, we just tell it the next hop. That's it. Let's do this by hand for two interfaces and specify two different routes, and then check with traceroute to the same server which route the packets will use. As you can see here, the route to Google's name server, 8.8.8.8, is different depending on the source IP. routing with the source IP of the WLAN 0 interface goes over the WLAN 0 interface, specifying a source IP on the Ethernet 0 interface goes over my normal LAN connection. Last but not least, let's have a look at the stop bond script. All this does is that it brings the bond interface down, removes it from the system, kills all instances of OpenVPN, and then deletes each route, rule, and tap interface. From the comments on the first video, I can see a strong interest on VPN performance, and especially using WireGuard for this. Guys, at the moment, I'm not very clear on how to achieve the bonding with WireGuard, other than, for example, using a GRE tap device over WireGuard, because WireGuard is ISO layer 3. So in order to increase performance, I thought, hey, why not just remove the encryption from the VPN? Now, before you tell me that I'm mad, let's take a step back and ask the question, why we are using a VPN at all for this? We are not using a VPN for the sake of privacy or using a VPN as such. We just do because we need to. In other words, our main concern here is speed, not encryption. And I'm not saying that we remove the authentication part. That remains. We just remove the encryption. Also, let's keep in mind that the malicious man in the middle would need to read all data streams in order to read the whole traffic. But in our case, they go over many different routes. Let's do some tests here. Let's open a VPN connection from this router to another router and watch the CPU utilization as we put some load on it. First with encryption, here we go. Then without encryption. Here we go. You can clearly see the difference. Perfect. Let me repeat my call to action from the last episode here. I do need your feedback. Where should we take this next? Having had a look at various comments and feedbacks from you and the issue you and I have ran into, I would suggest the following. We will not evaluate WireGuard for the time being, but rather make OpenVPN encryption optional. Second, I will work on a script version for OpenWRT, meaning that you could run this transparently on an OpenWRT router. Third, I will add options for failover and resiliency by doing a couple of things, making the balance strategy an option and running a watchdog that checks the latency and availability of the lines and would dynamically remove or add interfaces to the bond. This way, you could choose if you just want a backup line or if you want increased bandwidth or both. Last but not least, I will have a look into IPv6. This will be a learning experience for me as well, as I haven't done a lot with it in the past. Please let me know in the comment section what you think. Also, of course, please give me a thumbs up on YouTube if you like the video, and of course, subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss out on further episodes. Oh yes, and I will make a separate video on actually implementing 4G or LTE at various places, because when I was on holiday at my brother-in-law's place, it turned out that his cable connection sucks as well. But I will make a separate video on this because there are quite a few options from a router, band, and antenna perspective for LTE or 4G, which are worth a video on its own. This already concludes today's episode. I hope you liked it. If so, please share this video on social media such as WhatsApp, Facebook, Reddit, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Leave me a like and subscribe. Thanks for watching, guys. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.